Garden of Gethsemane, beaten, tortured, horrifically, nailed to the cross, and then died. They thought the story was pretty much over. And they were very much afraid that the same thing could happen to them. That's why they were behind the locked doors in the upper room. But then something utterly unexpected, amazing, dramatic, life-changing happened to them. They met the risen Christ. This wasn't a ghost. This wasn't an intellectual perception. Oh, that's how we now understand Jesus. He's kind of still with us. It was nothing like it. These were hard-nosed fishermen, by and large. And they met the Lord who had truly died and truly risen. They touched him. They ate with him. They experienced him. They saw the marks of his wounds, but he had truly risen. But they're kind of hankering after going back to their old lives. You know, without Jesus, they lived pretty kind of ordinary, safe lives. The majority were fishermen. So what does Peter say? Let's go fishing. And indeed, they went fishing. Galilee produced a lot of fish in the Sea of Galilee, not only for local consumption, salted and sold all over Palestine and even exported. He was probably kind of a middle-class businessman, middle-class fisherman. And after all, that's what he did. But they had fished all night and got nothing. And then this mysterious figure on the shore says, "Cast your nets on the other side." The fact is, at night, in the Sea of Galilee, fish tend to go closer to shore because it's warmer. So wise fishermen cast their nets towards the shore. But they had caught nothing. And then this stranger says, "Cast them on the other side," where the fish did not anchor. And they pulled in an enormous haul of fish. And it reminded them of one of their first meetings with Jesus, where the same thing happened. Peter wraps his kind of clothes around and jumps in the water. He's always impetuous and swims over where Jesus is. And of course, it was the beloved disciple. Evangelist John in verse 7, it's the Lord. I think we all have a tendency, after all the prayers and readings of Lent, all the joy of Holy Week, and we might have shouted the hallelujahs on Easter Sunday till our throats were wrong. Then, I don't want to go back to our old lives. Same old, nothing too dramatic. Living a kind of Christian life, a kind of Catholic life, not too on fire. And kind of have Jesus all in our little box that we understand and kind of contain. But that's not what the Lord wants of us anymore than he wanted with those first disciples. He wants us to be on fire with the great good news. He wasn't just about delivering the people of Israel from the Romans. He was about delivering all the peoples on earth. He wasn't just going to defeat Caesar. He was going to utterly defeat sin, death, and the devil. He is the beginning of a whole new way of life that's demanding and wonderful and inspiring. A life that we can live relationship to him. The disciples couldn't catch anything without him. And we can't accomplish anything in our lives unless we are listening to Jesus and connected to him. And then today's gospel ends with something I always find charming to hear when it goes around. Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of the world, the Son of God, the Alpha and the Omega, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, he makes breakfast for them. Come on, guys, let's eat. They dragged in, and I love it. One of the things the Gospel of John is he's always pays a lot of attention to numbers. So the beloved disciple actually sat down and counted 153 large He's still doing that today. He's still doing that this morning. That's the table of the Lord. Jesus feeds us with his word, and he nourishes us with his sacrament. He gives us that bread that has come down from heaven that ultimately satisfies all needs. We're here at this altar. We're united again with our beloved dead, those who brought before us. We're united with the angels who constantly worship God. And we're united with our Blessed Lady, St. Joseph, and all the saints. And this is the philosophy. This isn't the vision. It's true. Jesus, the risen Christ, is in our midst as our priest and as our food and drink, satisfying our every need. So let us invite the Lord to do what he did for those first disciples, to continue to change our lives and to welcome us into a new way of existing, always in union with him.